And you get this beautiful woman, you know, real knockout, and put her, just tell her to pass them by. You'll see heads turning and spinning round and round. You see tongues, you know, dangling and eyes wide open and breaths, the people, you can feel their hot breaths. But if you reverse this, if you get like 20 ladies and you put one real handsome person. Yeah, let's say, for example, if you get one of them actors, you know, famous actors, Mel Gibson or Tom Cruise, and he just goes in. You would probably find 6 or 7 of them, you know, being, wow, knocked out. But the others, he's not my type. You know, I don't like to look at him. I'm married. I'm a faithful person. I'm a good person. The temptation you get from women is far more greater and more dangerous than you get from men. That is why they are told to cover up, to put this partition, this shield between the gazes and the looks of others to them. If they are in a place that only women look at each other, it's different than where there's a place men look at them. Where there is a place that they intermingle or men do get a chance to look at them, they should cover from top to bottom because the temptation is there. But between males and females, if they're in a place like a swimming pool, again, they should cover their bodies in a sense that temptation is not probable or acceptable in such a place. Wearing bikinis is completely forbidden. Wearing a bathing suit, one-piece bathing suit, also for ladies is completely forbidden, unless she's in her house. And even her children will not be able to see her. If she has a swimming pool in her house, she's got to be rich. Well, that's nice for a change. But her husband is the only person who is allowed to look at her body. Other than that, she should be decently dressed. Yeah, she's not allowed to go exposed, even in front of women. Women are not allowed to wear miniskirts in front of each other. Of course, in front of men, it's even worse. But she is not allowed to wear miniskirts because her thighs is awra, is something of her body that should be covered, except and not to be exposed except to her husband and her husband alone. I think it's time for a break. Please stay tuned, and we will be, inshallah, back in a jiffy. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back to Youth Talk. Brother Tariq, I think that you had a question because you didn't look like at ease with my answer before the break.
I was just wondering, because Osama here said that, okay, you said that the dress code is from the belly button to the knee, okay?
For men, that is.
For men, yes. Yeah, I'm talking about men. But like if we now, like to in our present day, if we like look at swimming competitions, they fulfilled that, but like, okay, until their feet, but they were really tight. Like the swimsuit is really tight. So I don't know, what do you think of that?
Well, a dress code in Islam has few conditions that should be fulfilled and followed. One of which is that the dress should not be see-through. So even if you wear a thobe or a garment that is made of plastic, you can see everything under it. Man, that would look real hot, but it's not acceptable. It's forbidden. Why? Because you can see through it. And the second condition is that it should not be tight. Because if it's tight, you can know everything and as if the person is nude. But on the contrary, sometimes it's even worse than being nude. You know, you could find a woman or a person or a man wearing real tight, like in the ballet, those who dance the ballet. You can see everything, man. and unfortunately, it sometimes hides what may look ugly. So if the guy has like scars on his leg or a different color, or he doesn't have hair, or he has too much hair, while wearing these pantyhose or these pants or whatever, the stretches, it hides it, and it makes it look more attractive. So it is not acceptable. If you're going to hide the area, if you're going to cover the area from your belly button to your knee, it should not be tight. It should be a little bit free.
Hold on, but Sheikh.
Yes.
Like sometimes it's done because they're professionals, so they have to reduce the friction and some stuff like that. So they're not doing it because they want to show, but more like because.
Well, they say if you have it, show it. And yes, they are professionals, but before they are professionals, by default, they are Muslims. So it's their professionalism, their trade, their business, their job should fall under the parameters or between the parameters of Islam. If it doesn't, they have to reject it. I would not accept a person, a belly dancer, for example. She comes to me and says, well, excuse me, Sheikh, I have to dance between Maghrib and Isha prayer. So do you think it's acceptable if I delay Isha prayer a little bit, an hour or two, until I finish my dance? That's weird. That's I don't accept this. I don't buy this. So, well, this is a profession, Sheikh. I have to make a living. Yeah, you make a living by doing something that pleases Allah. By doing a sin, this is not acceptable. So to this professional person, says, yes, I know you're making good bucks. And I know you're breaking a lot of records. But you're breaking a lot of rules. And you are heading somewhere that is you don't want to go there. So if you were given the choice, you want heavens or a golden medal in the Olympics, what would you choose? Well, let me think. I need a couple of minutes. The minute you stop and pause for thinking, you've answered the question. So it should fall under the rules and regulations, instructions of Islam. To minimize the friction, what happens if someone else comes and tells you, well, if you don't wear anything, this minimizes the friction to zero, so you have more chances of winning. This might sound funny, but if somebody does come and professionally proves it, you will end up by having competitions and saying, well, it's for the sake of sports. And then sports becomes a god. People obeys and worship that god. This is not applicable in Islam. Any questions, please? Any more?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yes, you sort of touched on this. What if I play sports and say, for instance, I have a very important football match? Is it acceptable to delay my prayers and break my fast, you know?
Are you in a battlefield, jihad?
Yes. No. This is a football match.
This is a football match, for God's sake.
Contracts for a professional player state that, even during Ramadan, if he's playing for an international team, for example, outside in another Muslim country, in the contracts it says that for certain important games, even during Ramadan, he has to take the full meal and he has to...
What about if it says in the contract that you have to obey the religious orders of that country? So if you go to China, you have to bow to Buddha.
No, I'm talking about the certain stuff related to Ramadan. It doesn't say because of Ramadan. In Ramadan, you have to do that. But they say for certain matches, you have to have like the meal. You can't say, no, I can refrain from that meal now because I have a religious thing. Or...
No, you have to. There's no compromise.
Yeah, but they won't give you, you won't work, you won't sign for the team.
Again, you are in this choice. You have to make a choice. You want paradise or the golden medal?
Yeah, but at the same time, you want to make a living.
Well, if you work as a janitor, you're going to make a living. See, don't think of this life as if it's away and extracted from the whole universe. You are part of the universe. Look at all the birds that fly in this world. Like in your city, in your neighborhood, there are more than 10,000 birds minimum. What knowledge do they have? What college degree do they have? What experience do they possess? Nothing. Nevertheless, the Prophet ﷺ said that if you have trust and tawakkul on Allah the Almighty, He would nourish you. He would give you rizq. He would give you money. He would support you as He does with the birds that go in the early morning.